once again. Lord, we're thankful for a time of coming together as fellow believers where we can continue to pray, to sing, to read your words, to reflect on them, to think about how it is that you are calling us to continue to lean forward into relationship with you, and because of that, faithful relationship with each other and the world that we're living in. And so, Lord, we pray today that your words would speak to us, that we would hear what it is that your spirit would be saying to us as your church. We pray, God, that you would ready our hearts and that you would also give us the courage to hear what it is that you are saying and to put that into practice. Lord, we say all these things as we love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. It's interesting because this filter got a lot of play over the last 2 weeks on social media. Anybody remember this? A lot of play, a lot of interaction leading up to our holiday. Now, some use the filter because I believe they wanted to find a way to be in solidarity with Paris. And others critiqued people who were using this filter. Some people said folks were jumping on the bandwagon. Some people critiqued Facebook for having this filter and not having other filters of other different nations that had experienced different kinds of crises. There were important conversations, I believe, about who we choose to see as people and why. There were conversations around how white supremacy picks winners and losers in our world. But I believe that the vitriol behind the filter was even a little bit deeper than that. That it seemed that the conversation that was being had was about who is actually being seen. Whose life has value? Whose life is worthy? Whose life is important? Whose lives matter? I think this has been a conversation that certainly has been happening around our world with the emergence of the Black Lives Matter movement and call for justice over the last year and a half. But I also think it's important for us today that while we are having that very important conversation in our world, that we also have the conversation in our faith of realizing that while we are having the conversation of how we see one another, that we recognize that God sees us. And that because God sees us, there is an important and powerful way in which we can help to see one another. And so today I'm going to talk from the topic SawuBona. Everyone say SawuBona. Say it again, SawuBona. Say it one more time, SawuBona. So this word SawuBona in the Zulu, go to the next slide. This word SawuBona in the Zulu is a greeting that means I see you. It's a very powerful greeting that says and means, I see you. And the response of that word is Sikona. Everyone say Sikona.
Sikona.
Say it again, Sikona.
Sikona.
You thought you just came to learn about Jesus. See, I'm up here teaching you Zulu. You about to go back home and break out your Zulu card. SawuBona, Sikona. SawuBona means I see you. Sikona means, and because you see me, I am now here. I want that to just rest in us for a minute. This deep greeting that happened in our indigenous land. SawuBona means I see you. And Sikona, the response, means, and because you see me, I am now here. As we conclude our month of positive confessions, we do so remembering that while we can have all the powerful, positive confessions that we want to, the only reason we can have those confessions is because 2,000 years ago, God had a positive confession about us, which was SawuBona. It was God saying, I see you. Even in the middle of great challenge and great pain, I see you. Even in the middle of oppression and occupation, I see you. And our response to God, our faith in God, is the word Sikona. And God, because you see us, we are now here.
Yeah, yeah.
That Lord, if it hadn't been for you seeing me, Even in spaces where others do not see me, because you see me, I am now here. We're going to read from the Gospel of Luke, the first chapter. I have the verses up here, or you can read along in your Bible. Verse 26, it records, in the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." I'm telling you, somebody just needs to hear that in your spirit today. The Lord is with you. Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who was said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail." Amen. No word from God will ever fail. Mary replies, "I am the Lord's servant. May your word to me be fulfilled." Then the angel left her. We're going to be talking for the next few minutes about God's confession over our lives, SawuBona, I see you. Today is the first Sunday of Advent. Now, Advent is a season observed in the Christian liturgical calendar as a time of expectant waiting and preparation. For Christians, the season of Advent anticipates the coming of Christ from two perspectives, different ones. One is we remember the season of waiting for the initial arrival of Jesus in the world, and we commit ourselves to a season of waiting and preparation as they had to wait in preparation for the arrival of Jesus in the world. And also, we wait to be alert for the continual unveiling of God in our world. Amen. It is a season of waiting and a season of longing for the revealing of God in our lives. Now, we're living in turbulent times where waiting feels oftentimes antithetical to the moments we are experiencing. When Paris is happening, it's very difficult for people to wait. When Kenya happened back in April and no one talked about it, but then when we began to talk about it, it feels very difficult to wait. When Minneapolis happens, and we have a young brother who is shot by the police, and then subsequently have people who are peacefully protesting, shot by white supremacists, it becomes very difficult to wait. When Chicago happens the week of Thanksgiving, and we see another young brother killed by the police and shot 16 times, while his body lay on the ground, and the bullets are literally erupting from his body and from the concrete, it becomes very difficult to have this idea of waiting. Now, you pack all of that just also into the sense that we are part of the microwave age, where we don't like to wait for anything. Amen. We want to find a way. How can I get a filet mignon that takes 4 hours to cook to taste like that in 35 seconds? Right. We want to find ways. My wife is always, getting on me because the Thanksgiving food, she always wants to reheat it on the stove. But I don't like to wait, praise the Lord. As you can see, I don't like to wait. Amen. I like to go for it. But Advent is about waiting, not necessarily to respond to the realities of life, but rather waiting for God in the middle of these crises. It is a time to remember that we as humanity had to wait 400 years for the manifestation of love, hope, and the word that was made flesh in the life of Jesus. You see, the Hebrews had to endure rhythms of challenge before they could actually experience the arrival of Jesus in their life. I was reading this book that kind of deals with this idea of Exodus theology years ago, and one of the things that the writer was talking about was how the Hebrews experienced what he called Exodus, Empire, and Exile. Over and over again. That the Hebrews would be oppressed. They would be going through all kinds of slavery and oppression and being driven by forces against them. And they would cry out to God as they were in the middle of their pain. They would cry out for healing. They would cry out for deliverance. They would cry out for a change, and God would give them an exodus. And then after they got their exodus, they would come out of that place of pain and that place of frustration, and they would come into what was called Promised Land. And once they got into Promised Land, they began to set up their empire. Y'all know what I'm talking about. They would set up infrastructure, and they would find ways to protect this newfound experience of freedom. But there's something about building empire that causes you oftentimes to lose the cry that you had when you were oppressed. Isn't it interesting when you're dealing with oppression, there's a raw kind of cry that you have, there's a different kind of lament that you have, there's a different kind of faith that you have, there's a different kind of energy that you have that's very different from empire. So when they got to empire, they would build infrastructure, and then they would also try to design their lives to reflect their contemporaries instead of reflecting God. They said when we were oppressed, all we needed was God. But once we got an empire, we need a king. When we were oppressed, we just needed manna from heaven to feed us in the wilderness. But once we became an empire, we needed industry. Once we were oppressed, we linked ourselves together, but in empire, we now made it okay for us to kill and demolish other people to protect what we have. Once they get into empire, they lose their cry, they begin to look like the very thing that they came out of, and there in their rejection of God, they find themselves ultimately in exile. Now in a place that the cry is returning, because now you've lost where you've been. We're dealing with the shame and the disappointment of not following the way of God. And the whole story of the Hebrews in the scriptures are all about Exodus, empire, and exile. I love that because I think as you think about our lives oftentimes go through that same cycle of asking God to set us free. And then as soon as God sets us free, we don't need God anymore. Because now we figured it all out. I've got enough money to figure it all out. I've got enough power to figure it all out. I've got enough relationships to figure it all out until it all falls apart. Then I find myself back in exile going, oh God, why did you let this happen to me? And then we begin to cry out to God for another exodus. It is in this season that the Hebrews have been waiting that leads us to this place where we are in Luke chapter 1. Their humanity got the best of them as our humanity gets the best of us. And God is always inviting us into a place of waiting for God to do something new in our life. Now we wait not because it's natural to wait, but we wait because it is unnatural to wait. We wait as a way to resist our human nature to try to take over our lives. We wait to resist that to create room for God to show up. We wait to create margin for us to experience a move of God in our life. We wait to catch a glimpse of the holy and the divine in our life. Advent is where we remember that God sees us And because God sees us, we can wait even in the middle of crises. Yes. That we don't have to become like that which oppresses us, because we are waiting for that which is the manifestation of freedom. We wait because we recognize that the power to become free does not reside in our strength alone, but it resides in the power of God. The gift of God through Jesus is a profound message to humanity of SawuBona. I see you, and our response to God, SawuBona, is because you see us, we are now here. So let's think about this story of Mary. When God's message shows up to Mary with a messenger, Gabriel, in the town of Nazareth, that means it shows up in the hood. Look at the person next to you and say, God's message is in the hood. Some of y'all should like that, because you're about to go back home to the hood. Praise God. I am. Amen. God's message shows up in the hood. God's message shows up in a part of town that was occupied by Imperial Roman forces. I think it's important for us to not miss this in the story, that God does not choose to announce this angelic message. He doesn't choose to do so in the aristocratic circles of Judea. He doesn't choose to announce this in the imperial courts of Rome. But God goes and announces this message in the hood of Nazareth, on the backside of Galilee, where most people were illiterate, where the mortality rate was 40 years old. God says, this is where I'm coming to announce my angelic message. I want to lift that up for us to recognize that God brings his message into the heart of conflict. That the Hebrews had been through these cycles of exodus, of empire, of exile, that they had been through this, but God was coming right to the middle and the center point of that conflict. They had been living on the underside of empires so long that literally empires just took over the empires that were oppressing the Hebrews. Can you imagine being oppressed, and then someone takes over your oppressor, and then someone takes over that oppressor, and then someone takes over that oppressor, and you are literally living on the bottom of cycles and cycles of oppression. But God comes into the middle of this story after 400 years of silence. They did not have any prophetic declaration, and God comes into the middle of this story and says to the Hebrews, I see you. In the middle of your conflict, I see you. In the middle of great pain, I see you. In the middle of you having your taxes taken from the Romans, I see you. In the middle of seeing them take your daughters and rape them, I see you. In the middle of being totally destroyed, God says, I see you. Yes. While it's difficult to see at times, God is always present in the heart of conflict. God isn't blinded by the foolishness of man's actions or their refusal to follow God's way. God is in the midst of conflict. You can go to this next slide. Even when I was looking early this week at all of the protests that were happening in Chicago, as we were remembering the brother Laquan who was shot down, one might find themselves asking the question, where are you, God, in the middle of this? How many times are we going to keep seeing this and experiencing this? Have any of you all ever found yourself sometimes now just even fatigued by all of the videos, by all of the pain, where it oftentimes even feels like it moves you into a place of being immobilized? You just feel like, I don't even know that I can watch another video or I can read another article. Where is God in the middle of all of this? But I'm here to tell you that I actually believe, by looking at the stories of God in the past, that God is at the center of this conflict. Yeah. That God says, I'm here to tell you that my word is speaking at the center of the conflict. That God says, I have dispatched messengers and a message in the middle of these conflicts. That if the gospel that we follow, if the way of Jesus has nothing for then what message are we following? I love James Cone says, without concrete signs of divine presence in the lives of the poor, the gospel becomes simply an opiate, heroin, rather than liberating the powerless from humiliation and suffering. James Cone says the gospel becomes a drug that helps them adjust to this world by looking for pie in the sky. What Cone is arguing, I believe, and what I hear from it is that the gospel is not coming to make us numb from the pain, but actually to help us find the gospel in the middle of the pain. That in the middle of these crises, in the middle of it, when we hear the gospel, recognize that God says, I show up in the middle of a contradiction, and you must be waiting and listening for my message in the middle of the challenge. That God says, I am not the God only of the resolution, but I am the God of the conflict. Now to me, this is the joy of the gospel, that the good news of the kingdom of God is not just for the resolution, but for the conflict. Because since God can handle the conflict, this gives us hope that we can handle the conflict. Since God speaks words of life in the middle of the conflict, we can have positive confessions in the middle of the conflict. We protest not to be rebel rousers, but rather to proclaim and speak God's words in the middle of these conflicts. Amen. We say you can't stop the revolution, not because we are the genesis of the revolution, but because God is the genesis of the revolution. We chant it is our duty to fight for our freedom, not because we are bound by some law or duty, but because we know God is the source of freedom. And fighting for freedom is to pursue the presence of God. We say Black Lives Matter, not because we're trying to convince somebody of something, but because we are echoing God's SawuBona that says, I see you. And because we know God sees us, and because we know God sees the oppressed, and because we know God sees the marginalized, we commit ourselves to see them as well. Amen. The story of Mary receiving this message is the story of God showing up in the middle of conflict. Yes. Now sometimes, hearing God speak in the middle of conflict with affirmation can feel unbelievable, can cause us to push back. There's times where I don't want to have a conversation with God when I'm mad. Any of y'all ever been there? I know y'all very spiritual people here, right? But sometimes when I'm upset, I don't want to talk to God. I'm kind of like, God, I actually know how I want to handle this situation, and I'll call you later with the news of how it went. Right? You know, I'm going through the time of my life. I was, you know, tell some folks as a father where, you know, I'm needing to grow as a father because I got beautiful daughters that are wonderful and articulate and smart and bright and all of that. And so there's a lot of people that oftentimes want to be around my daughters that I don't want them to be around. Amen. And sometimes I want to hang my Holy Ghost on the tree. Sometimes I have hung them on the tree. Amen. But I need God to help me, amen. Because I need to wait for God. But we have those times where we're like, God, I don't need your help. I actually would like to deal with this on my own. So we need to recognize that God being present in conflict doesn't mean that we're always going to be feeling like waiting for God. But we must push ourselves to wait for God. In this story, the angel begins to announce to Mary that she would be overshadowed by the Spirit of God and subsequently would produce Jesus. That her physical limitation of virginity was not a boundary for the move of the Spirit of God. That the Spirit comes and tells Mary, the messenger comes and says, the Spirit is going to overshadow you, and as the Spirit overshadows you, you will produce someone who is going to come and articulate the SawuBona of God over humanity. And that nothing in your life has the ability to constrict what God wants to do through your life. Now Mary had been living a life that found her ready to receive what God had in store for her, and living her purpose. Mary had been waiting on God's arrival through faithfulness. She was ready. Somebody say ready.
Ready.
Mary was ready to be used by God. As we are entering this season of Advent, one of the other things that we want to be waiting for is, how do we wait so we can make ourselves ready to be used by God? You see, oftentimes we don't know what God wants to do in the world. We don't know what God wants to do in our families. We don't know what God wants to do in us. But we must wait so God can make us ready to be used by God. God wants to conceive hope for your generation, inside your life, inside your family, inside your community, inside those you love. But God wants to start inside of you. A part of waiting for God's coming is about readying ourselves for his arrival. Which leads us to this question. Are you a ready womb for God's conception in your generation? Now, I'm not going to get too much into the... biology of that whole process of conception. But I think the question is important. Are you a ready womb? Are we fertile and ready? Available for God to conceive some things in our lives that actually are expressions of hope in our generation?
Yes.
When you think about Mary, I want us to appreciate Mary existing in a paternalistic society. In a patriarchal society. In a place where she, as a young woman, was not necessarily going to be seen by her society as one that would be a ready person to do something that would bring salvation to the world. She was not an obvious suspect. But because Mary found herself faithful, because Mary found herself ready and waiting for God to show up in her life, Mary was positioned to produce Jesus. And we don't have Jesus unless we have the readiness of Mary. So if God could come all the way to the hood of Nazareth and find a young woman who was probably only about 14, 15 years old, if God could come and find a young teenager and say, out of all these people that are around, you are the one that I find a ready womb. You are the one that I find to be a vehicle that I can actually save the world through. You are the one that I actually am choosing to change the very future of the world. If God could do that through Mary, what might God want to do through your life? What might God want to do through our church? What might God want to do in our community?
Amen, amen.
Look at the person next to you and say, are you a ready womb? Are you a ready womb for God's conception? Could it be that some of the things we're praying for, God actually wants to do in you? You're praying for God to send somebody else. Lord, I need you to send somebody to come and deal with this person over here. Because if you don't come and deal with them, Lord, I'm going to cut them. I swear I'm going to cut them. Lord, you ready? And God is saying, I'm not sending nobody. I'm calling you to be a ready womb. To become someone that can be an instrument of healing and grace. That we must be a ready womb. There is a quote that I want to share. Synonymous, that says, you don't get to pick your time. You get to pick what to do. Because your time picks you. I'm going to read it again. You don't get to pick your time. You get to pick what to do. Because your time picks you. Last year, was it last year? Yeah, I think it was last year. We were starting off doing some of our training of police departments. This was in May, June, somewhere around there. And we were starting to do some training of police to try to help do some training around implicit bias and around helping them understand the reason why particularly communities that have been oppressed don't like them. Amen. Just to be candid, right? Not all of them, but y'all know what I'm saying, right? Like there's a history behind some of this. And so at the time, myself and a few other leaders, we got involved and said we were gonna help to try to do some of this work and find ways to volunteer and help to retrain the police. And so the first class that I did to help train the police in Oakland, we did the class, and it was a terrible class. It was a terrible class. I'm not gonna go all into it, but it was a terrible class, amen. I walked out of there saying, I am never doing this again. Because I got my own trauma, and some of these folks in here looking at me like I owe them something. I just felt like taking off my shoe and just, throwing it across the room. I told y'all, being the Holy Ghost, sometimes I wanna put them on a tree. Y'all gotta pray for me. Then the next week, Michael Brown was shot. And as you all know, Pastor Mike was in Ferguson, and so I'm texting him, I'm watching the news, and he's texting me on all the stuff that's happening and is going on, and I'm just sitting at my house getting mad. Man, we gotta do something, And I'm getting mad, and so that next week, I had to teach the police again. And I remember I was driving in my car on the way to the police department. And I was like, ooh, I'm about to give them a piece of my mind, right? And as I'm driving, I believe the Spirit spoke to me and said, now I have you at a crossroads that you're either going to go in there and do what you want to do, which will ease your conscience and make you feel good. You can go and just give it to the cops, like give it to them, just tell them off, leave, guns a-blazing, smoke, just leave all in a big, I got it out of me. Or you're gonna submit to me and allow me to help you really do this training in a way that'll push some things forward. Yeah. Talking about being a ready wound.
Yes, sir.
Because out of that, that training that we did has now become the model for the whole nation. And now we're training police departments across the state. And it's informing work that's happening in D.C. What am I lifting up for us? This is not a clap for Ben Space. What I'm lifting up for us is all throughout our lives with the problems that are happening in the world, God is inviting us to be a ready womb.
Yes.
For God to birth things that we might not necessarily think we would actually be qualified to participate with. But God's gift is birth inside of you. Now, God birthing something inside of you means that we've got to have faith. We've got to have faith to believe that God wants to do something in us that we otherwise would not see in ourselves. We're just coming out of Thanksgiving, and I'm the kind of person, when you talk about preparing oneself, I try to prepare myself for Thanksgiving. Y'all know what I'm talking about. So I try not to eat for about 12 to 18 hours. Amen. Because you got to make some space, right? Somebody say, make some space. I mean, need to make some space. Now, Brittany, my daughter, would tell you, I don't do that good with making space because I go in and out of the kitchen while my wife is still cooking. But in any case, I'm trying to make space because I'm in expectation of what's going to come out of that kitchen. Because when I watch those sweet potatoes go inside the kitchen, and I watch those macaroni noodles going, when they go inside the kitchen, they're just ingredients. But when I see them going into the kitchen, hope begins to arise inside me. I begin to believe that something is going to happen in the next 24 hours that's going to be a blessing to my life. Right? I sit there. And as the ingredients begin to be mixed, there is an aroma that begins to come in the air. That also begins to seed my expectation, right? Now, I haven't tasted anything that actually is proof that I should wait and not eat. But I'm smelling things.
Yeah.
I've seen some things that cause faith inside me to believe. Thanksgiving anointing. Some of y'all need to go and receive that, right? And some good is going to happen if I wait. It's the same way in this season of Advent and waiting for God that we don't have proof that something good is going to happen. But through the scriptures, we have ingredients.
Yeah.
Through one another's stories. people's lives, we have an aroma that we smell. And I believe what God is always calling us into is to wait, recognizing that I want to create a meal, I want to birth something inside of you that will bring healing to the nations. Yeah. So not only does God show up, this SawuBona, does God see us in the middle of conflict, does God birth life inside of us, but also we must recognize that as God begins to do this in our life, we must receive it with faith. Even though Mary had reason to doubt the messenger and his message, she chose to receive God's words with faith. Mary chose to receive and wait for God's arrival in her life with faith. I love the way that it says it in the King James Version, where it says, "Be it unto me according to your word." Mary says, "I don't know how this can happen. I don't know how you might birth some hope in the middle of this situation. God, I don't know how you're going to do something in me in the middle of Nazareth. I don't know how you're going to do something in me in the middle of Roman occupation. I don't know how you're going to overcome the fact that I'm a virgin and I've never been with a man. But Lord, if you want to do something in me that transcends what I understand and transcends what I know about myself, then Lord, let that be unto me according to your word." What would it look like if we began in our positive confession to God to say, "Lord, I recognize my limitations. I recognize the areas where I'm weak. But Lord, whatever it is you want to do through me and in me, Lord, I'm available for you to let it happen. Lord, you know that I want to cuss folk out. You know I want to put them in a headlock. You know I want to kick somebody's door down. You know I just don't want to be bothered. But Lord, let it be unto me according to your word. Lord, you know that I'm actually tired of coming to church. I'm tired of reading your words. I'm tired of hearing these people tell me these same old messages. I'm tired of receiving a prayer and having somebody spit in my face." If you don't get that, that's just because you ain't been around a Pentecostal church long enough. You know. I receive it, but man, I'm not trying to get a shower, right? You know. Lord, I'm tired of all of that, but Lord, let it be unto me according to your word. This is where our positive confessions that we've been talking about, these post-its that we've been holding all month, our positive confessions can help us wait for God. Receiving God's word with faith is to agree with God's word over your life. Agreeing with God means that I don't see how the current climate of xenophobia in the world that is ruling our country and our narrative, I don't see how the kingdom can emerge from that. But Lord, let it be unto me according to your word. I don't know how we're going to see justice emerge out of all the state-sanctioned violence, but Lord, let it be unto me according to your word. I don't know how our communal violence is actually going to lead to peace, but Lord, let it be unto me according to your word. I don't know how the challenges in my life will be overcome, but Lord, let it be unto me according to your word. Receiving the word with faith means we receive it. I'm going to give you this acronym for faith: full assurance in the heart. That faith is a full assurance in the heart. That we say, "I am persuaded that neither death,
yes, sir,
nor life, nor angels, nor demons, nor anything will be able to separate me from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus." That's in Romans chapter 8. "That nothing will separate me from the love, and I will not allow my fear to cause me to miss God's SawuBona over my life." God says, "I see you." I believe some of us need to hear that today. In the middle of where you are in life, in the middle of where our communities are, God says, "I see you." No matter what Donald Trump says, or the silly people that stand with him, God says, "I see you." that they can dehumanize you, they can discredit you. The systems of our world can say that you don't matter, but God says, I see you. And may our waiting be, Lord, an expression of Sikona, because you see me. I am now here.
Thank you, Jesus.
Is it not John 3:16 where Jesus says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but will have everlasting life. Is not John 3:16 a clear demonstration of SawuBona, of God saying, I see you, and because I see you, you are now here. We can have faith to overcome, to move beyond our fear. Malcolm Gladwell, as I close with this quote, in David and Goliath, the book says, the conquering of fear produces exhilaration, and the contrast between the previous apprehension and the present relief and feeling of security promotes a self-confidence that is the very father and mother of courage. That when we conquer fear, we find ourselves available to live out courage. Stand on your feet with me. We're waiting for the continual SawuBona of God to rest in our hearts while we ready ourselves to live out SawuBona with each other. God sees us. Because of that, we want to see each other. As we begin this waiting season of remembrance and celebration, may we sense the arrival of God into the middle of life's conflicts. May we be ready wombs for God's conception. And may we find ourselves with the faith that says, let it be unto me according to your word. I want to just invite us to just have a moment of reflection as we listen to our worship team sing a song that brings us into